See, I want to share you the our syllabus of differential geometry. You can see the syllabus on your university website itself also. Okay. So this is what the first paper: functional analysis, then ADM, then linear algebra, differential geometry, which is SCT 3.1, then numerical technique, which is for OET, not for you. So let me go for the syllabus of differential geometry. See, in the unit one, initially we have seen tangent vector field, frame, reparametrization, directional derivative, differential form. In the last part, we have seen a speed of curve or how to find out an arc length of the curve. Okay. So today we will complete our unit one and we'll go for the unit 2, in the unit 2 we will go for the Frenet formulas, isometries and covariant derivative basically. Okay, so for that let me go through your recommended book. This is what a cover page of recommended book is. O'Neill B, author of this book is O'Neill B, and the name of book is Elementary Differential Geometry. Actually, this has 7 parts, so this is what the 0th part of the book. And from the 0th part, we are studying only the 4 chapter. So this is what simply an introduction of a differential geometry. Okay, you can see that everything is explained very nicely, and the many exercises are also given. And you can go for the solving the exercises. If you are having any doubt for solving the exercises, you can go for the last pages. You can see here we are having total 817 pages, and maybe from 600 onwards you may go through the all the solved exercises. Okay, let me show you somewhere after 600 pages. See here the exercises which all the solved example, all the exercises are solved. Okay, so this is what whatever the exercises provided in our book. What is the name of book is Elementary Differential Geometry, and all the exercises are solved in this. Okay, you can see here. So this you can see the page number 103, exercise 6. So everything is provided, and if you want to solve the exercises, you can see here exercise number 6, page number 103, the example is solved, second one. So you can see the examples of isometry are solved, examples of f is equal to t are solved, right? Okay, so first you should download this book from your Google Classroom. I have shared this book in the Google Classroom, and somewhere from the 600 pages, all this solution of exercises are provided. If you are having any doubt for solving the exercises, you can go for the last pages of this book. Every example is solved. Okay, so I suggest you to go through the book, because this is very important book for your if you are going to study differential geometry, correct? You can see everything is given very clearly, each and every definition. And if you are having any example, so the figure of example is given, how to plot a point on the 3D space is given. I have given you one homework, that how to plot a point on a 3D space. I think no one has done this. You can see the figure here, figure 1.1, on the page number 7 of your recommended book, in which if you want to plot a point 3, 4, 5, you can plot this point like this. Okay. First, you have to plot a distance 3 from origin, then 4, and then 5. And then combinedly, you can plot a one cuboid, and with the help of that, the resultant of cuboid will be in this direction, and this direction will give you the point 3, 4, 5. It is very easy to plot a point on a 2D, but how to plot a point on a 3D space, that you have to study. Okay, I have given you this homework, but no one has given me or no one have a किसी ने भी मुझे मैसेज भी नहीं किया कि ये कैसे सॉल्व किया. सो यू कैन सी हियर ऑन द पेज नंबर 7 ऑफ योर रिकमेंडेड बुक फिगर 1.1 हाउ टू प्लॉट अ पॉइंट एंड दिस इज व्हाट वी हैव डन दैट हाउ टू एड द टू टेंजेंट वेक्टर्स वीपी एंड डब्ल्यूपी विद द हेल्प ऑफ पैरेललोग्राम लॉ. ओके सो दिस इज व्हाट यू कैन सी हियर वी आर हैविंग द UP, the tangent vector, if it is in positive direction, 2 times UP, if it is in negative direction, that is in the downward. So you can see here, we seen the theorem that any tangent, any vector field can be written as a linear combination of the natural frame fields, right? You can have the example of a helix that we have seen. So first we are having a circle in XY plane, then as the height increases, we will get a helix. And this is what an intersection of a sphere and a helix. I think if you are going through a Google Classroom, I have shared the animation and the images also, how the intersection of the helix and the sphere occurs. So this is what the reparameterization, how the reparameterization works. And these are the exercises. All the exercises are solved. You can go through the exercises from the 600 pages. See, all the examples are also solved. Some example are in the exercise. Right. Now let me go for our last part of this chapter. Everyone able to hear me now? No one is answering anything. So let me go for the last part of this chapter is curve is constant if and only its velocity is zero. We have to prove that. Okay, what is our aim to prove that a curve is constant if and only if, what is if and only if here, its velocity is zero. What is our aim to prove that? First we have to assume the curve is constant, then we have to prove that velocity is zero. In the second part, we have to assume velocity is zero, then we have to prove that a curve is constant. Okay. So let me prove this if and only part one by one. Okay. Let us assume that a curve alpha is a constant. That means it may have simply C1, C2. Okay, so how to find out velocity now? We have seen in the last lecture how to find out the velocity of any curve. Simply find alpha dash of t, that is we have to differentiate each and every coordinate with respect to time t. And if we are having all the coordinates are constant, then if you have to differentiate with respect to t, derivative of a constant term is zero, then we get alpha dash of t is zero. Then how to find out the velocity or the speed of the curve? It is norm of this, so norm of zero will be again zero. So what I get, speed of curve is zero and alpha dash of t, that is a velocity, this will also be a zero. Okay, let us go for the second one. Let us assume that alpha dash of t is zero. What is our aim to prove now? The curve is a constant. If alpha dash of t is zero, let me integrate with respect to t. What I get, alpha of t is equal to integration of this constant term or zero. So what will be integration of this? I will get it as simply one constant term, right? So hence we can solve this very easily. What is provided to us? Alpha dash of t is equal to 0. Or in another way, you can write it as alpha dash of t is equal to 0. That means alpha 1 dash. This is alpha 2 dash. This is alpha 3 dash. Right? So hence, if these 3 are 0, it means that your curve alpha of t is a constant. Okay? Let me repeat once again, a curve is constant if and only if we have given that a velocity is 0. You have to prove in the two parts. First one, you have to assume a curve is constant, you have to prove velocity is 0. And secondly, we have to assume velocity is 0 and then we have to prove that a curve is constant. Okay. Let us go for this. If alpha of t, assume that a curve alpha is a constant. Constant in that alpha of t will be having only the coordinate as some constant number. So just differentiate alpha dash of t. So what are the derivative of constant term? It is 0. Hence alpha dash of t is 0. It means that velocity is 0. And here let us assume that velocity is 0. Then just integrate. You will get the integration with respect to t will be a constant. Okay, let us go for the next one. A non-constant curve is a straight line if and only if its acceleration is 0. A non-constant curve is a straight line. What is our aim to prove? If and only if its acceleration is 0. Correct. So what is given to us in the first part? A non-constant curve is a straight line. That means we have provided that we are having a non-constant curve which is a straight line and we have to prove that acceleration is 0. How you are going to write down equation of a straight line? I have told you that I will have to write down it as p plus tq, right? The t is a parameter. And if you want to write down coordinate wise, it will be p1 plus tq1, p2 plus tq2, p3 plus tq3, right? So hence, now if I want to prove acceleration is 0, what I will do? In the last lecture, I have given you a definition of acceleration. What is alpha dash of t? This is velocity. Just differentiate this terms, that is all, each and every coordinate with respect to time t. P1 is a constant term, derivative is 0. What is the derivative with respect to time t? It will be q1, then derivative with respect to t. For the second term, it is q2 and the last term is q3. So what will be alpha double dash of t? That is your velocity, right? So what will be acceleration? So what is acceleration? As q1, q2, q3 are nothing but again a constant number. What is given to us? P and Q are any two points on the R3 space. If P is with the coordinate, say P1, P2, P3, Q will be with the coordinate Q1, Q2, Q3. So these are simply your real numbers on your R3 space. Okay, so what will be Q1, Q2, Q3? These are real numbers. So what is the derivative of constant term? It will be again 0. So what we get, the acceleration we have got, it is a 0 vector. So hence we can say alpha double dash of t. If it is equal to 0, we can say this alpha double dash is nothing but your acceleration. Alpha dash is a velocity. So hence we can say acceleration is 0 when you are having a curve alpha of t is a straight line. Okay. If you want to imagine this on a real life, suppose you are traveling on a straight line. Right. Obviously, if you are on a straight line, you have velocity will be constant. Here we are getting alpha dash of t is a one constant. Okay, q1, q2, q3, all these are real numbers. Now, if suppose I am saying what should be acceleration if you are traveling on a straight line. Agar aapka speed, aapke bike ka speed constant hai, toh acceleration 0 hi aayega na. What is the acceleration? How you are finding acceleration in the physics? Acceleration is nothing but dv by dt. That is rate of change of velocity. If velocity is constant, agar aapka velocity constant hai, agar aapka bike same speed se ja raha hai, to obviously acceleration 0 hoga. So that's why we can say acceleration is zero. Why? Because your velocity is constant. Okay. Let us go for the second part. What is given to us? Alpha double dash of t is zero. Now, if I integrate, what I get? Alpha dash of t is equal to some constant q. What will be alpha of t if I integrate once again? It will be qt plus some another constant t. And if you are confused, let us name it as c1. Then it will be c1t plus c. Okay, so this is what an equation of a straight line p plus tq form. So hence we can say now if acceleration is zero, the corresponding curve alpha of t will be a straight line. And these are if and only if. Hence one implies another. If another is given to you, you can imply the second. Okay, so hence let us go for the last one. A vector field y is parallel if and only if y dash is equal to zero. In the last lecture, we have discussed that what is vector field. As you already know that what is a vector field, at every point P of a E3 space, if I am able to draw a tangent vector and collection of all those tangent vector at every point P of a E3 space is a vector field. Now, if I want to have a vector field on a curve, so at every point I can have one tangent vector. Every tangent vector may be in a different direction, and collection of all this will give you a vector field on a curve. Now, what is a parallel vector field on a curve? Parallel vector field you have already studied on a 3D space. If all the vectors are going in the same direction, then you can say that all the vectors are parallel to each other. Parallel to each other means what? They have same direction, but point of applications are different. Let us go for this. That is, if suppose all the tangent vector are in the same direction on the curve, so we can have this collection of all these. I can say this is a parallel vector field. Now, what will be direction of this? We have written in the last picture that it is c1, c2, c3, or you can have any vector field y can be written as summation ci ui. Correct? But ci's are the constant. Why ci's we are writing? Because all the m have the same vector field. Okay, vector part is same, but point of applications are different. Okay, now if we are writing like this, y is nothing but c1, c2, c3. So what will be y dash? Obviously, if c1, c2, c3 are constant, what will be derivative of constant? Is zero. Hence the proof, if we are having y as a parallel vector field on a curve, then we can say that y dash is equal to zero. For a parallel vector field means what? All the tangent vector on a curve will have the same direction. Point of applications are different, but the direction vector is same. That is, direction is constant. That I can write it as y can be written as a summation ci ui, where ci's are constant. If you take a derivative, then y dash will be zero. Okay. Now we'll go for whatever we have seen in the first chapter. Okay, let us remind everything whatever we have seen in the first chapter. Okay, starting with the basic point. What we have seen in the basic points? We have seen in the basic point that how to write down the equation of a straight line, equation of a plane, equation of a circle. Then what will be an equation of a plane with two point, with one point? If we are having three point, how you will write down the equation? What we need for writing an equation of a line, one point on the line and a direction vector. What we need for rewriting the equation of a plane? We need a one point on the plane and a normal to the plane. Okay, these we have studied in the basic. Right. Now what we have seen in the differential geometry, as we know that differential geometry is a study of a curve and surfaces. Rather, we are going to study smooth curve and smooth surfaces. Okay. Now, in the differential geometry, everything is depending upon a E3 space or R3 space. Why we called it is a E3 space? Because it was given by Euclidean, hence it is called a E3 space. How you write the elements of E3 space? It is a three tuple vector, and every coordinate of this three tuple vector is a real number, right? If you want to write down 1, 2, 3, that is one vector. What is 1, 2, 3? These are real numbers. Okay. So after that, we have seen what is a tangent vector, right? What is a tangent vector? It must have two points. First one is point of application, and second thing we need is a vector part. Okay, how you write this? This is the point of application P, and this is P plus V. We can name it as V to the suffix P. This is a tangent vector. Okay, after this we have seen how to write down the addition of a tangent vector. V plus W at a point P. We have written it is V P plus W P. I have given you in detail description how to write down this vector addition and scalar multiplication. A V P is nothing but scalar A into VP. It depends on scalar A. If it is positive, negative, depending on that, it will be changing. Okay. Next, we have seen a vector field. What is a vector field? It is nothing but collection of all the tangent vector once at every point P of a E3 space. Right? After that, we have seen what is a directional derivative. What is directional derivative? We have defined directional derivative of a function F at a point P in the direction of V is nothing but this is initial rate of change of a function f at a point P in the direction of a tangent vector V. Why the directional derivative is important? Because it will give you the direct rate of change in any direction. What is the direction of V? We don't know. So what is the important part of directional derivative? It will give you rate of change in any arbitrary direction. And after that, we have proved one theorem that it is nothing but summation over I Vi dou f by dou xi. Right, it is nothing but Vi are nothing but the coordinates of your tangent vector Vp, that is V with the coordinates say V1, V2, V3. What are V1, V2, V3? These are real number. What is dou f by dou xi? These are nothing but the partial derivative. So we have written directional derivative is nothing but linear combinations of the partial derivative. Okay. So, what is the directional derivative? Why it is important? Because it will give you the rate of changing in the arbitrary direction. And we have seen some examples based on the directional derivative. Okay. Then we have written directional derivative. Instead of writing on tangent vector, we have written it on a vector field. Df at a point P will be nothing but V of P F. That is, if you want to find out a directional derivative on a whole vector field, it is equivalent to find out on a each and every point. What is a vector field? It is nothing but collection of all the tangent vector once at every point P of a E3 space, right? And if you want to find out a directional derivative of a function f on whole vector field, that means I have to go at every point P of a E3 space. Agar main yahan pe jaati hu to mujhe ek tangent vector milta hai. So how to find out the directional derivative of a function f on the tangent vector? It will reduce to our original definition, that is definition of directional derivative on the tangent vector. There is a difference in Vp and V of P. This is on the vector field. That is, if I am going to change a point P, there will be change in the vector in our vector field. So here there is, both are fixed. Point of application is also fixed and the vector part is also fixed. Okay. So this definition reduces to directional derivative on a tangent vector. And we have seen some examples on this also. Okay. After that we have seen what is reparametrization. Reparametrization means what? If your given curve alpha is with the parameter t, you have to work with some new function h in such a way that we have to write down beta as alpha composite h, and beta will be now in terms of s. The changing parameter t to s is called a reparametrization. Before reparametrization, we have seen parametrization. That means if any equation you are having You can write that equation in terms of parameter. Writing any equation, any geometric figure in terms of a parameter is called parametric equation. And this parametric equation of any curve is not unique. That I have given you with the example of a circle. Okay. So reparametrization we have seen, and we have seen what is the relation between the derivative of reparametrizations. Okay, how to find out a velocity. After that, we have seen arc length and velocity. What is the velocity? Alpha dash of t. Why we are calling this velocity? Because if you are suppose alpha of t is given to us, this is a curve. At every time t, you can check what is the velocity of your bike. Okay, and this is, suppose you are traveling on a bike from some point A to B. At every time t, you will have some different velocity that you can calculate with the help of alpha dash. Okay, that is what a tangent vector at every point, or it is called a slope of tangent. So this alpha dash of t will give you the rate of change at every point of the curve. Okay, hence this is alpha dash of t is a velocity. So what will be alpha double dash of t? This will be acceleration. Okay. And what? How to find out an arc length? Arc length is nothing but integration a to b norm of alpha dash of t d. Or you can write alpha dash of u du, right? And if you want to work on how to find out the relation between arc length and the time t, then you have to write down integration 0 to t alpha dash of u du. And we have seen how to solve the example that we have to convert a curve alpha with having different speed, you have to convert it to unit speed curve. Okay, finding a reparametrization in such a way that the new curve, whatever we will obtain, will be having a unit speed. How to do this? With the help of arc length. First, you have to find out the arc length of the function. This is very easy because if you know the curve alpha is given in the